Now, lots of ancient buildings, they do lean, but the Leaning Tower of Pisa just looks like it's defying the law of physics. And that's all to do with its centre of mass, which is just about here.
Experts calculate the tower's centre of mass is around the fourth floor. As long as this sits above the base of the building, it will stand. But if it moves outside of that area, you have a disaster.
Calculations show that when the tower was at a lean of about 5.44 degrees, it should have collapsed. Now, by 1990, it was already at 5.5. It should have gone down. No one knows why it didn't collapse.
With so many rescue efforts over the centuries, the calculations of the lean have become confusing. To make matters worse, the lean compounds an issue hidden in the walls that could take the tower out before the lean knocks it over.
The greatest danger for the Tower of Pisa has not been that it should simply fall over because of its weight. There are other dangers as well, one of which is the incredible amount of stress which is produced on certain areas of the tower due to the weight of the tower.
The tilt strains the walls, which can be devastating to a structure built from solid stone. But while these look solid, the walls are filled with a random mix of building materials, making them less sturdy.
There has been a great concern that the tower would rather burst and implode rather than topple over.
Not only could the tower have fallen, it could have exploded at any point. It defies belief that it's still standing.
After decades of discussion, design, and prototyping, in 2003, the go-ahead to build the barrier was finally given. The aim of this ambitious project was to divide the Venetian lagoon from the Adriatic Sea by placing barriers across three inlets. A total of 78 mobile gates needed to be laid at the bottom of the seabed. Each one is 28 meters long, 20 meters wide, and weighs a colossal 300 tons.
MOSE consists of a series of gates that lie flat on the seabed, and they're hinged at one end. And to activate them, air is pumped into the gates, and through the principle of buoyancy, the gates rise up, providing a barrier between the Venetian lagoon and the Adriatic Sea.
The design was revolutionary and would allow authorities to open and close the sea gates to cope with tidal surges of up to 2.7 meters. At least that was the plan. But to match the biblical scale of this project, the catalog of catastrophes has been almighty as well, becoming a joke amongst Venetians.
So what they didn't think about was that when the barrier's up, tidal forces can push sand and silt underneath the barrier, so it can't sink back down properly.
Engineers realized that when the gates were raised, sand would settle in the trenches, which meant that when the gates were shut, they couldn't close properly. The materials used in the construction of the barrier have already shown significant signs of wear.
Another really difficult problem is corrosion. The gates that were installed underwater are already showing huge signs of corrosion, and gates that haven't even been put in yet that are on the land are starting to rust. So this is going to render them much, much weaker and can lead to huge mechanical failures in the future.
The barriers are made out of these big metal panels, and the paint is being corroded. That's also something that, you know, is a well-known feature of salty water.
The gates are corroding, even the replacement gates are corroding. Clearly they chose materials that just couldn't withstand salt water and sea air.
To add insult to injury, a tiny Venetian resident is causing huge extra problems.
What they didn't also think about was the environment at the bottom of the sea. There's lots of mussels and all sorts of creatures down there, and they start to live on the brackets, on the hinges, meaning that sometimes these hinges are inoperable.
There was some issue with the hinges, and lo and behold, there were mussels growing on the hinges.
And the only way to deal with that is to have divers go down and literally scrape them off, which just seems ridiculous.
By the late 70s, having failed to prevent the fire from spreading closer to the town, residents were warned that Centralia was unsafe. But most people stayed put until a dramatic event convinced them of a very real danger.
When coal seams burn underground, they undermine the integrity of the surface. Frighteningly, this can result in sinkholes opening up, revealing the burning coal below.
That's exactly what happened on Valentine's Day 1981, when a young Todd Domboski was exploring his grandmother's backyard.
Right now we're standing in front of the home of Todd Domboski, the young 12-year-old boy that fell into the sinkhole. Now that sinkhole was in the backyard, which it's hard to get to with all these brambles and stuff here, but it was about 30 feet back on the right. He saw a puff of steam coming out at the base of the tree, so he went over to see why. And when he got there, the ground just went out right from under him and opened up. And steam shot about 50 feet in the air.
Miraculously, the boy was hauled out by his cousin and survived.
Eventually, it attracted all the major news media in the country and the world, really. Usually, a mine fire didn't cause too much attention before. But that shone the spotlight on it. And then the end result was what you see now. Everybody left.
By chance, state politicians were visiting that day and witnessed the aftermath. They insisted that the state intervene. But with the underground fire now so huge, extinguishing it was no longer a viable option.
It was Centralia. It was just finally a matter of money. What's going to cost more to dig this huge barrier and surround the coal and just buy everybody out? And so they decided to buy everybody out as a cheaper alternative. I think it was $42 million as opposed to $200 million to do that remediation operation.
The government offered residents a substantial cash sum to leave. But despite the cracking highways, noxious gases, and sudden sinkhole, many people in Centralia were still reluctant to abandon their homes.